Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. The Little Book of Big Dividends, a safe formula for guaranteed returns, by Charles B. Carlson. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Foreword. Finally, sensible investing made simple. I have known and interviewed Chuck Carlson for over 20 years. He never changes his tune to fit fashion or fad. He just goes along making money, consistently, as his stocks pay dividends. And since only companies that have profits can afford to consistently pay dividends, these stocks have a record of increasing share price as well. Now, he has made it even easier. In this audiobook, Chuck starts with his basic principle. You can make big money by investing for the long term in dividend-paying stocks. He has even created a free website to help you find those stocks. And to top it all off, he shows you how to buy many of these stocks, either a one-time purchase or regular small or large monthly investments, at no cost, no commissions, no fees, directly from the company. You might be wondering where this secret has been hiding all these years. Well, it has been hiding in plain sight. For all the years I have known him, Chuck has been trying to explain that investing doesn't have to be complicated, expensive, mathematical, or time-consuming. Maybe it's just that now we're ready to listen. We've seen genius fail, and technology lead us astray. We've watched Nobel Prize-winning economists lose billions, and astrophysicist investment bankers blow trillions. The markets have survived all this hubris. Now it's time to get back to basics. The idea of investing for dividends sounds rather quaint, something your grandfather did in the olden days. So you might be surprised that from 1926 to the present, dividends have accounted for 43% of the total return of the S&P 500 index. Dividends fell out of favor until recently because corporate executives were paid bonuses based on stock performance. Thus, they had an incentive to use the company's excess cash to buy back shares instead of paying dividends with the money. The share buybacks boosted the all-important measure, earnings per share. With higher reported earnings, stock prices soared, and so did executive bonuses. We've lived through the sad results of that strategy. We've learned that even the best and brightest can't beat the market forever. You remember that old saying, if you can't beat 'em, join 'em? In the Little Book of Big Dividends, Chuck Carlson shows you how to join the stock market's unprecedented record of long-term growth. First, you have to understand the importance of dividends to overall total return. It will require an amazing suspension of disbelief, in this era of gratification, to accept the fact that a 3% annual dividend, reinvested regularly, can grow wealth over time. Yet that's just what the S&P 500 has provided, with dividends reinvested over our lifetimes. Then you'll have to step back from the logical presumption that if 3% is good, perhaps 10% is better. As Chuck explains, an extraordinary dividend yield is a dangerous temptation, a warning of trouble ahead. Perspective is critical. Those who stretch for yield without quality will soon learn the truth of that old saying, I'm not as concerned with the return on my money as I am about the return of my money. Finally, for those millions of boomers who will soon be searching for income in retirement, this book provides you with a roadmap to monthly dividend checks that will smooth your retirement planning process. Unlike annuities that offer fixed monthly payouts, dividends can provide increasing stipends as the company grows. Unlike bank CDs, which offer only a guaranteed principal and yield that could be dented by inflation, dividend-paying stocks also offer the potential of growth to keep up with inflation. So before you dismiss the idea of investing for dividends as either hopelessly old-fashioned or totally boring, remember the old fable of the tortoise and the hare. The tortoise lived to a ripe old age and is enjoying retirement in Florida. So will you, if you dedicate at least a portion of your investments to the principles explained here in the little book of big dividends. Terry Savage. Terry Savage is the nationally syndicated Chicago Sun-Times financial columnist and author of 4 books on personal finance, the latest of which is The New Savage Number, How Much Money Do You Really Need to Retire? Introduction. I'm a rarity in that I have been with the same company my entire working career. My first day on the job at Horizon Publishing was August 16, 1982. Back then, the company moniker was Dow Theory Forecasts, named after the investment newsletter that my firm still publishes today. There's nothing noteworthy about August 16, 1982. But August 17th, 1982 was special. On that day, my second day on the job, mind you, the Dow Jones Industrial Average rose nearly 39 points. That may not sound like much, but in 1982 it was huge. A nearly 5% move, or the equivalent in today's terms, of 500 points on the Dow. On that momentous day, the Dow Jones Industrial Average closed at 831.24. August 17th is pegged by market historians as the beginning of the raging bull market of the 1980s and 1990s, an 18-year period when the Dow Industrials rose from a little over 800 to nearly 11,500 by the end of 1999. I mention 1982 because of one big similarity I see between the stock market then and now. In 1982, attractive dividend-paying stocks were bountiful. Indeed, many companies were sharing a portion of their profits with shareholders every 3 months by sending them hefty dividend checks. How big were the dividend checks? It was not uncommon for stocks in 1982 to pay shareholders dividends that equated to a yield of 6% or higher. Think of a stock's dividend yield as the interest rate you get for owning a stock. And these were quality companies with the potential for their stock prices to rise sharply. It was like shooting fish in a barrel, although I didn't know enough at the time to realize it. For example, had I the foresight and the money to invest a few dollars in some dividend-paying stocks on my first day on the job, I would probably be boogie boarding in Bora Bora right now. Indeed, $5,000 investments in 2 quality dividend-paying stocks, Philip Morris and Exxon, on August 16, 1982, would be worth more than $1 million. And that's after the market crash of 2008. And it wasn't as if you had to be Warren Buffett to come up with those 2 gems. Exxon was a Dow stock in 1982, so it was hardly undiscovered. And Philip Morris produced products all of us knew, and some of us even loved. In hindsight, these stocks were no-brainers for dividend-loving investors. No-brainers that made you rich. Are there quality dividend-paying stocks in today's market that are just waiting to make you rich? The answer is yes. Finding them may not be quite as easy as finding them in 1982, but make no mistake, there are dividend-paying stocks in today's market that will make you rich. Now is a great time to be a dividend investor. Really. Like 1982, today is an excellent time to be a dividend investor. That may be hard to believe coming on the heels of 2008 and 2009, 2 of the worst years ever for dividends. How bad? About 1 out of every 8 stocks in the Standard & Poor's 500 Index reduced or eliminated the dividend in 2008. Approximately 15% of the companies in the S&P 500 index cut or omitted dividends in 2009, the highest level ever. So, why do I think there are tremendous opportunities in dividend-paying stocks? Partly because of the massacre of the last few years. A stock's yield is determined by two things, the dividend and the stock price. If a stock price declines, its yield increases, provided, of course, that the company continues to pay the dividend. When stocks were crushed in 2008 and early 2009, the huge price declines lifted dividend yields to levels that, in many cases, I have not seen since 1982. High dividend yields are only part of the bullish story because stocks fell so much in 2008 and early 2009, prices reached ridiculously low levels. Even with the market's rally beginning in March 2009, it is not uncommon to see stocks trading below prices they fetched a decade ago. The bottom line is that when you consider their bargain basement prices and high dividend yields, dividend-paying stocks are as attractive today as they have been in nearly three decades. A recipe for riches. If you want the recipe for getting rich in the stock market, here it is. Find stocks with above-average appreciation potential and safe and growing dividends, and buy them at attractive prices. This audiobook shows you how to do just that. In the pages before you is a blueprint for successful dividend investing. I'll walk you through the basics, what a dividend is and isn't, why, how, and when companies pay dividends, and why some companies pay big dividends, while others pay no dividends at all. That's all in Chapter 1. In Chapters 2 and 3, I discuss the importance of size and safety of dividends when considering dividend-paying stocks, and I introduce you to a simple formula for finding big, safe dividends, or what I call BSDs. This formula takes into account factors most critical to the safety and growth potential of a company's dividend. I define and discuss each of these important factors and show you how they can be used to rank dividend-paying stocks. As you'll hear, my BSD formula has an excellent track record of spotlighting attractive dividend-paying stocks while isolating those where dividend cuts or omissions are most likely. This chapter also shows the benefits of combining the BSD formula with other investment tools to improve your odds of finding the best stocks for dividends and price appreciation. My gripe with a lot of investing books is that they tend to be long on theory but short on specific, actionable advice and recommendations. Chapter 4 names names, taking the ideas and tools from the first three chapters to create lists of my favorite stocks offering big, safe dividends. And we go global. It has never been easier for any investor to buy shares of foreign companies. International investing has become increasingly popular, and this chapter spotlights those foreign stocks that are the most attractive for dividend-seeking investors. Finding attractive dividend-paying stocks is only one piece of the puzzle. Buying them is another piece. Fortunately, it has never been easier or cheaper for investors to buy stocks with big, safe dividends. Chapter 5 explores the most cost-effective ways for any investor, even those with limited pocketbooks, to buy these stocks. Brokers represent one way to build these shares, but you can also buy stock directly from the company, the first share and every share, without a broker. With these plans, you can buy shares with very little money down, $250 or less, and pay little or no commission. And that's not just U.S. stocks. A growing number of international stocks, including those with big, safe dividends, allow any U.S. investor to buy shares directly, without a broker. I'll show you what companies offer the plans and how to get started buying stocks directly. Inflation is the enemy of any investment program. One way to help stave off the effects of inflation is to make sure your portfolio includes companies with a habit of boosting their dividends. Chapter 6 discusses the importance of dividend growth and highlights stocks with big, safe, and fast-growing dividends. Americans are getting older. With age comes an increased demand for cash flow. One reason dividend-paying stocks represent an excellent source for cash flow is the ability to synchronize dividend payments with cash flow needs. Chapter 7 shows you how to organize stocks based on dividend payment dates in order to construct portfolios that pay you big, safe dividends every month of the year. A helpful budgeting tool to meet your monthly bills. If you can sync an iPod, you can sync your investments with your cash needs. While this audiobook concentrates on dividend-paying common stocks, investors have a growing menu of investment choices to generate cash flow. Preferred stocks, real estate investment trusts, known as REITs, master limited partnerships, open-end and closed-end mutual funds, and exchange-traded funds, known as ETFs, are just some of the many investment vehicles investors are turning to for dividends. Chapter 8 takes a walk on the wild side by explaining the pros and cons of these often risky but potentially high-return investments. Buy low, sell high, is every investor's mantra. The reality is, however, that few investors buy low and sell high. We usually buy high and hope to sell higher. The reason is that buying low is hard. Stocks fall because of bad news, a bear market, lousy earnings, product missteps. And avoiding bad news is hotwired into most of our DNA. In order to take advantage of market declines to buy low, you need a strategy that takes emotions out of the decision-making process, a strategy that forces you to buy stocks even when you're afraid. Such an investment strategy exists. It's called dividend reinvestment. With dividend reinvestment, your investing is on autopilot. You buy stock even when you are freaked out by the market. Actually, when most investors are freaked out by the market is precisely the time you want to be buying. Dividend reinvestment plans aren't just great tools for forced buying. The plans offer a way to turn a little money into a lot over time. With dividend reinvestment plans, if you don't have enough money to buy a full share of stock, your money will buy a fractional share, and that fractional share is entitled to a fractional part of the dividend. It's like buying stock on the installment plan. And believe it or not, there are some dividend reinvestment programs that allow you to buy stock with your dividends at a discount to the market price. Chapter 9 discusses these programs. The audiobook closes with what I call the ultimate big, safe dividend portfolio. This portfolio features attractive U.S. and international stocks and funds with big, safe dividends. I show you how to construct the portfolio based on dividend payment dates, so you'll get a dividend check every month of the year, and how to use low-cost direct purchase plans to purchase many of the investments. As you'll see, anyone can start to build this portfolio with minimal amounts of money. One reason I wanted to write this book was to dispel a lot of myths about dividend investing. Indeed, much of what is written about dividends is inaccurate or incomplete. Don't get me wrong. Dividends are great, but they are not the free lunch they are so often made out to be in the press. To address some of these myths, as well as to reinforce what I think are important concepts when it comes to dividend investing, I've included a yield box at the end of every chapter. What I want you to do when you hear me say yield is exactly what you do when you see a yield sign while driving. Slow down and assess the situation before advancing. If you remember only these simple ideas, you'll be way ahead of the pack when it comes to dividend investing. I have a confession to make. When putting this book together, I was a bit frustrated by its size. In my books, I love to provide lots of lists and tables and statistics and ratings covering hundreds of stocks. But it is tough to do that in such a compact format. There was so much more I wanted to include. The good news is, the internet has virtually unlimited space with which to work. which makes it the perfect complement to my book. To that end, I have provided tons of dividend information on the following website. BigSafeDividends.com. It's all one word. I'll say it again. BigSafeDividends.com. You'll find up-to-date dividend ratings, yield information, dividend payment schedules, and other relevant data on every dividend-paying stock in the Standard & Poor's 1500 Index. The site provides literally a one-stop shop for all things dividends and is a powerful tool for researching dividend-paying stocks. And by the way, all the information is provided free of charge. Time to get busy. Finding dividend-paying stocks that will make you rich may not be as easy as shooting fish in a barrel. It isn't August 1982, and the Dow Jones Industrial Average isn't at 831. Thank goodness. But the big opportunities are out there. By purchasing this audiobook, you have upped your chances dramatically of finding them. Happy hunting. Chapter 1. The check is in the mail. Get paid to invest with dividends. The controller of my company is named Pam. Besides being a great controller, Pam has a great smile, one of those toothy ones that lights up a room. I always enjoy seeing Pam's smiling face, especially every other Friday. Everyone in my company loves to see Pam's smiling face every other Friday. That's when Pam hands us our paychecks. Payday never gets old. I don't care if you've worked a week or a lifetime. Payday is always a great day, a day never to be taken for granted. Why is payday great? Besides the obvious, payday represents that weekly, biweekly, or monthly validation that what we do matters, that we aren't simply wasting our time, that we are adding value. Of course, you may feel other emotions on payday, perhaps jealousy, maybe a little resentment. Still, getting paid is really why we do anything. The pay may not always be in dollars. The currency may be that buzz you get when you volunteer your time, coach your daughter's softball team, hike your favorite trail, or send that check to your favorite charity. Getting paid is why we get up every morning, and getting paid is why we invest. Investing may not always feel this way. I didn't exactly feel as if I was getting paid to invest in 2008. It felt as though I was doing the paying. Still, we invest to get paid. Otherwise, we wouldn't do it. How do we get paid for investing? Two ways. One, the value of our investment goes up. You buy a stock at $10 and it jumps to $20. You made $10 on your investment. That $10 profit is called a capital gain. If you sell and lock up the profit, you have a realized capital gain. If you still hold on to the stock, you have an unrealized gain. And two, we receive a portion of the company profits on a regular basis. As a shareholder of a company, you're an owner. As an owner, you have a claim on the profits of the company in proportion to your ownership. The board of directors of your company may choose to keep those profits and reinvest them back in the company. On the other hand, the board may decide to distribute part or all of the profits to the owners. Let's say a company's board has made the decision to disperse 30% of its profits that year to shareholders. If profits are $2 million, shareholders receive $600,000. Your claim on that $600,000 depends on your percentage ownership. If you own 1% of the company, you'll receive $6,000. That $6,000 is commonly called a dividend. Dividends are usually paid quarterly, every 3 months, although some companies, especially foreign firms, pay dividends only once or twice per year. Companies may differ in the months when they pay their dividends. Some companies pay dividends in March, June, September, and December. Some pay in February, May, August, and November, Others pay in January, April, July, and October. Knowing the dividend payment dates can be useful when constructing a dividend portfolio to provide regular cash flows to meet financial obligations. I'll show you how to construct dividends every month portfolios in Chapter 7. A stock's total return, the total amount you get paid for investing, is capital gains plus dividends. Let's say you own a stock that goes from $10 per share to $11 per share in a year. During the year, the stock paid 50 cents per share in dividends. The stock's total return for the year is 15%. That is, $1 per share in price appreciation plus 50 cents per share in dividend divided by the starting value of $10 per share. As you can see, dividends represent an important component of a stock's total return potential. In fact, roughly 40% of the stock market's long-run total return comes from dividends. Why dividends matter. When you examine the two ways of getting paid to invest, capital gains and dividends, it's natural that dividends have special appeal. A stock's capital gains potential is influenced significantly by what the market does in a given year. Sure, stocks can buck a downward trend, but most don't. On the other hand, dividends are usually paid whether the broad market is up or down. The dependability of dividends is a big reason why investors should consider dividends when buying stock. I'm not suggesting that every stock you own must pay a dividend. However, there's something to be said for the bird-in-hand theory of investing, that a steady, dependable dividend stream provides nice ballast to a portfolio's return. Procter & Gamble, the consumer products giant, has paid a dividend every year since 1891. Procter & Gamble's stock price has not risen every year since 1891, but shareholders who owned the stock at least got paid a little during those down years. They weren't totally dependent on capital gains to get paid. Another attraction of dividends is that they can grow. Johnson & Johnson, the healthcare company, has raised its dividend every year for more than 45 years. Shareholders received those growing dividends regardless of what happened to the stock price in a given year. And the rising dividend stream not only hedged against inflation, but also accelerated the payback on investment. Here's an example of what I mean by payback on investment. If you had invested $5,000 in Johnson & Johnson at the beginning of 1985, held the stock until today, and reinvested dividends along the way, your annual dividends from J&J stock would now be more than $7,100. In other words, your paycheck on your initial investment via dividends is more than 100% every year. Now that's the power of dividends in an investment program. To pay dividends or not to pay dividends. The stock market is really a market of a bunch of small companies. Probably 80% or more of all publicly traded stocks have market capitalizations. Market capitalization is figured by multiplying outstanding shares by the per-share stock price, of less than $1 billion. In fact, a healthy chunk of all publicly traded companies have market caps that are less than $100 million. Fewer than 300 companies have market caps above $10 billion. In short, the typical stock is not IBM.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.